La revolución de 1910 en esta primera etapa es una revolución de personas formales, personas decentes. Entonces, el hecho de que un líder fuera reconocido en todas partes como bandolero le pesaba mucho a Madero, y prácticamente Madero hace a un lado a Villa.
In October 1911, Francisco Madero sweeps the presidential election. There is a sense of tranquility all across Mexico, but this period of peace will be short-lived. Almost from the beginning, Madero's grip on his presidency is weak. He has the support of Villa, but loses the backing of one of his early allies, General Pascual Orozco.
Madero quería que se reformara el sistema político sin una revolución. Y cuando la revolución triunfa, él pone límites muy claros. Él no quiere desmantelar todo el sistema.
Ambassador Henry Lane Wilson has little regard for Madero. He believes Madero is the wrong man to run Mexico. Wilson sees himself as the arbiter of U.S. policy in Mexico. So he begins his own campaign to undermine the Mexican president.
Wilson is there receiving the indications of the building coup, encouraging it, reporting very dire warnings to Washington. The country is in chaos, all our interests will be lost, the lives of Americans are in danger, despite the reports from the consuls, which indicated quite the opposite.
For Zapata, it's clear. With Madero, there is no future for agrarian reform. The entire region of Morelos starts to slip from Madero's grasp.
Zapata had revolted in the name of Madero, but Madero had never controlled him. And what Zapata wanted was an immediate land reform. Madero fought against him. He was, in the final account, an hacendado. He was not willing to agree to any expropriation of people from his own class.
Y entonces rompe el movimiento campesino con Madero. El gobierno maderista da la orden de luchar por desarmar a los zapatistas y fue una lucha muy cruenta.
Zapata promulga el plan de Ayala el 6 de noviembre de 1911, levantándose en armas contra Madero, nombrando al jefe de esa revolución, a Pascual Orozco.
Emiliano Zapata and Pascual Orozco joined forces, posing a serious threat to Madero. Orozco had been Madero's ally in the beginning, but was pushed aside because the general had defied the president at the Battle of Juarez. But the way Madero handles Orozco will come to cost the president more than he could ever imagine.
When there's the break between Madero and Orozco, Madero turns to Huerta to lead the federal troops against Orozco, somewhat reluctantly, because Huerta had a reputation already. He was a thug, he was a drunkard, he was corrupt. Huerta then goes after Orozco with complete impunity when it came to squashing the Orozco rebellion, because he saw this was the opportunity for Madero to be beholden to him, Victoriano Huerta.
Ambassador Wilson supports Huerta, but in Washington, there is little respect for the general. He's too unpredictable and ruthless. So the Taft administration begins to look for options in the event that Madero is ousted. Although Orozco is considered a hero by Mexicans, he has declared himself to be anti-American. But in the northern states of Chihuahua and Durango, popular support for Villa keeps growing.
Y en la medida en que el liderazgo de Villa va creciendo, Estados Unidos lo apoya, porque además Villa demuestra una simpatía muy grande por los norteamericanos. O sea, de 1913 a 1914, Villa no tiene más de que halagos para los norteamericanos. Entonces, saben del poder que tiene con el pueblo. Y mientras ese poder lo pueden controlar, dejan que se desarrolle.
General Villa chooses to play it smart. He doesn't take sides. This way, he gets what he wants, U.S. support and American weapons. In the summer of 1912, Madero attempts to gain favor with the Zapatistas by taking a new approach. He tries to work out concessions, but the military leaders in Mexico City, including Huerta, accuse him of undermining their war with Zapata.
Huerta considered himself a self-made man, but he was the son of a mestizo and a Huichol Indian woman. This was a man, under any other circumstances, would be among the poor of Mexico during the Porfiriato. And I think Huerta had a streak of self-hate. He was ashamed of his past. And that shame led to a desire to do away with those people who reminded him of who he had been, of who he no longer wanted to be. And I think, to some extent, that self-hate reflected itself in the ways in which he was so vicious in his military campaign against the Zapatistas.
Huerta was a typical caudillo, the man on horseback in Latin American politics, and Henry Lane Wilson saw him as superior to Madero.
Ambassador Wilson keeps up the pressure. He argues that by removing Madero, U.S. interests will be protected. The ambassador grows even closer to Huerta, and the plot to eliminate Madero takes shape.
Y en 1913, el embajador norteamericano juega un papel determinante en el golpe de Estado de Victoriano Huerta.
The warning came very clearly to Wilson from Huerta that they were going to make a move against Madero. And so you have a kind of shadow play. Wilson is taking his initiatives, but he has inside information.
In February 1913, Mexico City is engulfed in a flood of violence. It's a war zone. Known as the Ten Tragic Days, this horrendous battle, begun as a mutiny, is orchestrated by Huerta to destabilize the Madero government. Behind the scenes, Ambassador Wilson continues to support Huerta.
Y a principios de 1913, las condiciones están ya perfectamente dadas para que Victoriano Huerta, junto con un grupo de militares porfiristas, decida ejecutar al presidente Francisco I. Madero y al vicepresidente José María Pino Suárez.
On February 18th, President Madero and Vice President Pino Suárez are arrested in a coup arranged by Huerta with the blessing of Ambassador Wilson. Madero's wife goes to Wilson and begs him to intervene and save her husband's life. He tells her, "Your husband's downfall is due to the fact that he never wanted to consult with me." Huerta's men tip off the prison guards that there may be an attempted prison break by dangerous criminals. On the night of February 22nd, just outside the walls of the Lucumberri prison, Madero and Pino Suárez are assassinated. Huerta becomes president of Mexico.
Villa felt that he would avenge Madero's death and that he would continue the revolution that Madero started, though in a very different way from what Madero would have done.
The news of Madero's assassination sends tremors across the country, releasing waves of hatred towards Huerta.
Cuando es asesinado Madero, lo que hace Victoriano Huerta es destapar los reclamos del pueblo, que ya no son el respeto al voto y estas cuestiones, sino que ya es el reclamo por todos los años de dictadura, por todo el cúmulo de injusticias que se habían forjado durante 30 años de dictadura.
With Madero out of the way, Ambassador Wilson has his wish. But he has a new problem. In Washington, Huerta's ruthless coup has created a crisis of confidence, and the ambassador's influence begins to slip. On March 4th, 1913, Woodrow Wilson becomes president of the United States. He summons Henry Lane Wilson to Washington and dismisses him as ambassador to Mexico. The Wilson administration refuses to accept Huerta's regime and begins to shift its support to the new alliance of revolutionary generals Carranza, Obregón, and Francisco Villa.
Francisco Villa logra reunir un contingente numeroso y gracias a sus éxitos, gracias a su liderazgo, todos los demás jefes van a terminar nombrándolo a él el líder de todas las fuerzas que habían surgido aquí en Chihuahua. Villa destaca muy pronto entre todos los jefes militares que surgen después del golpe de Estado militar de Victoriano Huerta y se convierte en jefe de la División del Norte y logra muchos triunfos. Pero aquí hay un factor que se tiene que tener muy presente. Villa era un jugador, le gustaba el azar. Muchas de sus grandes proezas no fueron fruto del cálculo meticuloso, seguro. Muchas acciones de Villa eran azarosas.
Villa's survival skills, instincts, and luck have served him well in life and on the battlefield. But now a more complex, enigmatic Villa begins to emerge. His tactics on and off the battlefield are sometimes spectacular. Yet some of his most important innovations are practical, like his extensive use of the railroad.
For the Villistas, the railroads were decisive because they allowed the soldiers to rapidly go from one area to another. The soldiers would sit on the roof, the horses in the cars, and it gave the Villa army a tremendous mobility. It also gave Villa a unique opportunity to care for his soldiers. All his trains were followed by hospital trains. And also, it allowed Villa to do something that Zapata had less interest in, namely take the families of the soldiers along. In the trains, the soldaderas, the women, fulfilled a very useful function. They foraged for food, cooked, tended frequently to the wounded, and many of these women fought as well.
Valentina, Valentina, yo te quisiera decir.
Las mujeres iban arriba en el techo con los hombres mojando.